तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः दिस इज अ बिट ऑफ टेक्निकल टॉपिक दैट इज गोइंग ऑन नाउ आई विल ट्राई टू ओवर गो थ्रू इट क्विकली वृत्ति व्याप्यत्वमेवास्तु फल व्याप्ति कथं भवेत् स्वप्रकाश स्वरूपत्वात् सिद्धत्वाच्च चिदात्मनः द प्योर कॉन्शियस सेल्फ बीइंग सेल्फ इल्यूमिंड एंड सेल्फ डिटर्मिंड There can only be vritti vyapti. The phala vyapti cannot exist. In simple words, vritti vyapti means appearance of thought in the mind, and phala vyapti means the ownership of the thought. In a realized person, there is no ownership of the thought. There is seeing without a seer. There is hearing without a hearer, experiencing without a experiencer. And this is your natural state, mind you. This is your natural state. You have never become a seer, doer, seer, thinker, knower, experiencer. You are imagining. The word itself is saying err. You are erring somewhere. You are erring somewhere. So your natural state is seeing is happening, hearing is happening, experience is happening. But some stupid fellow comes up and creates a continuity in all that is happening and says, I am the experiencer, I am the seer, I am the hearer, I am the knower. And individuality begins. So you have to break that. So here, this is... so when it says that the pure consciousness self being self-illumined and self-determined. Self-illumined, it does not need any other light to illumine itself. And self-determined, it does not require anyone to validate it. It is self-existing. See? And that you are. And in your presence, all the thoughts are coming and going. Whatever is seen, whatever is heard, whatever is experienced, it's happening. There's no place for seer, knower, experiencer to be born. And this is how a wise man lives in his life, lives on this planet. So if that is how he lives, what does the seeker should do? He should stop becoming a seeker. He has to stop becoming a seeker, because then he is seeking. There is something sought.
Nothing to be sought.
But here, seeker is seeking himself, his own essential nature. How can the subject come to know the subject? Not possible. How can the eyes see the eyes? Not possible. How can the I come to know the I? Not possible. Because I is self-existing. Is self-knowing. It does not need a medium of thought to know itself. Isn't it? See, it sounds very simple. But depending upon where our disposition, who we are taking ourselves to be. If you become a thinker, you're gone. So let thinking go on. You remain in that poise, then things will start happening. Start happening means you will fall in that position. I will not elaborate on that. That much is enough. The following shloka now proceeds to describe the videha mukta state. Arthadarthe yatha vrittihi.
Arthadarthe yatha vrittihi.
Gantum chalati nantare.
Gantum chalati nantare.
Anadhara nirvikara.
Anadhara nirvikara.
Sadasha sonmani smruta.
Sadasha sonmani smruta.
Sir, here the unmani avastha is being mentioned. As there are modifications in the thoughts when they pass from object to object, such modifications are absent in the absence of the object. Such modifications are absent in the absence of the object. That means the thoughts are formed in your mind when you are going from object to object, word to word, experience to experience. But when there is no object to go from one to the other, there's absence of all objects, then is there thought possible? No. There's not thought possible. This is what he's saying. Such modifications are absent in the absence of object. So now what is there? And a void is there. An emptiness is there. Zero mind is there in the absence of objects. Then it says, this state of thought is called anadhara or nirvikara. This is also known as the unmani state, where mind is no longer objectifying anything. If it objectifies, thought will come. Now it is not objectifying, thought is not appearing. If thought is not appearing, I is not appearing. Only if object is there, subject will be there. If object is not there, subject is also, as a thought is not there. Unmani avastha. Expose yourself or your mind again and again to this disposition. It is again and again you have to come to this point. And if the more you come to this point, somewhere along the way you will fall back into yourself. I'm going faster. Thoughts in our mind are always about objects. When the object is gone, subject have got no reason to be called a subject. Subject is called subject only with respect to object. If object is not there, subject is not required. As a thought, as a I. If I is without a thought, then what is there? Only the self. We may ask, how is it possible that all that is seen is Brahman alone? What happens to the world when the Brahman is perceived? How can the world appear projected on Brahman? Chittam chitcha vijaniyat.
Chittam chitcha vijaniyat.
Takara rahitam tayada.
Takara rahitam yada.
Takaro vishayadhyasaha.
Takaro vishayadhyasaha.
Japaragau yathamanau.
Japaragau yathamanau.
As the color of a red hibiscus appears to be superimposed on a crystal glass next to it, in the same way, when consciousness is accompanied by the thought of the object, it is called chitta. The takar or letter ta is the superimposition of the objects on the chit. So just understand, don't get too much, not nirodha. This is not about Nirodha. This is about how can the world appear to be superimposed on the or projected on the reality. If reality is one without a second, from where is the world appearing? That is what the question is. If everything is because phenomena is going on. If you are on a hot day, the sun rays themselves appear as water of mirage. It's not something else. It's the rays itself appearing as mirage. And sometimes, most of the time, they are not there. But under certain conditions, they appear. So what is that certain condition? when they appear. That hot ground has to be of a particular temperature, the angle of the sun has to be at a particular angle, the sun rays, then that happens. When does Jagrat Avastha, Swapna Avastha, Nidra Avastha, waking dream and deep sleep happen? Certain condition has to happen, then alone it will happen. When will hearing happen? Not through your eyes, it has to happen. When there is a sound and you are having healthy pair of ears, then hearing will happen. Exactly the same way the teacher is asking, how does the world get projected on the reality? So here they are given an example. As the color of the, if there is a crystal or there is a glass and a dining table is of the blue color cloth and the glass is kept or a crystal is kept on the table, it looks like a red crystal. But is the crystal, you take it away from the table, it is clear, it is colorless. You put it back on the table, it becomes red or it becomes blue, whatever the color of the cloth is. Same way, you wear the dark glasses, you will see the world dark. You wear red glasses, you will see the world red. You see the world clear glasses, you will see the world as it is. Isn't it? So, are you seeing the world red, or is it because of the superimposition? So here, that color of the tablecloth has got superimposed on the clear crystal. Exactly the same way, the absolutely immaculate self or Brahman, to it the thoughts come, and we say that the world has come about, we say there is conditioning, we say there is waking dream and deep sleep. And in this way, in the same way, when consciousness is accompanied by the thought of the object, so when do we see ocean as ocean, or do we see ocean as wave when we are at the beach? Wherever your attention is. If your attention is on the wave, after waves that are coming, you will see the waves. But you know that there is a larger ocean, isn't it? Which alone is appearing as waves. So here, when they say that this consciousness, when name and form is introduced to this consciousness, within this consciousness, water with a name and form is called wave. Consciousness with name and form is called chitta. See, consciousness or mind without name and form is consciousness. What we said 2-3 times, we have mentioned that before. And this is the way takara. So chitta means consciousness, chitta means the mind. So what has happened to the consciousness? Takar is added. Takar means a sense of otherness is added. Name and form is added. Something else which is we can't say foreign, because consciousness is all that there is. But something is imagined within it. Some addition, it is one, but something else is added to it. Water is one, but a wave is imagined in it. Then it is called chitta. When objectivity is added to it, it is called chitta. And this is how the world is projected on the reality. Continuing. How may one dissolve the distinctions of the knower, known, and the knowing? Nyaya vastu parityagat.
Nyaya vastu parityagat.
Tishtati kevalam. Triputi kshinatameti.
Brahma nirvanam rishati.
In the renunciation of the object of knowledge, only pure knowledge remains. The trio of the knower, known, and the knowledge disappears, and thereafter one comes to the experience of Brahman as objectless awareness. So what does it mean? I told you the other time that there are three: knower, known, knowing. If the known is taken out, in fact any one of them you take out, the whole thing breaks down. So if the objective knowledge is taken out, that which you know, then the knower and the knowing has got no meaning. What will it know? Knower, the I, the supreme I, the pure I, is called as knower only with respect to the known. The pure consciousness becomes the subject only with respect to the object. But if object is itself not there, then is there any purpose of the subject? This is the I, this is the world. If this I is identified, you are called the individual. If you have separated from it, you are the subject, this is the object which you are being witnessing or observing or knowing or seeing or hearing or experiencing. Now if all, so this is with respect to this subject and object. If object is taken away, then will the subject as a thought, I, remain in the mind? Mind reverts back to its original state, liberation, realization. It's that simple. To bring this about, chitta vritti nirodha, forcefully people do it. But that is artificial. We have to come to the kevala sthiti. We have to come to a point where nothing disturbs us, whether the object is there or not there. Once we have realized we are this, the moment we realize this, because this alone is expressing as I, now it no longer matters. If this appears, there is no knower, yet knowledge takes place. Knowledge without a knower is how the master functions. Hearing without a hearer is how the master functions. Experiencing without an experiencer is how the master functions. Perceiving without a perceiver, this is how the master functions. It is only knowledge at the moment. But it is you think it is knowledge. It is happening to you right now. Between every two thoughts there, seeing is taking place. No seer is born. You are experiencing, but no experiencer is born. Between two thoughts, you are there, but there is absence. Are you saying continuously, now I know absence? No, there is nothing to know, but yet you are. In the renunciation of the objects of knowledge, only pure knowledge remains. This is the pure knowledge. Pure knowledge is wisdom. Where Triputi comes, it's impure knowledge. Where knowledge is of something without a knower, that is pure knowledge. Then what will it be? Then everything will be the I alone. There is no owner. There is no value giver. There is no attention giver to the object. And in this way, one comes to the experience of Brahman as objectless awareness. Drop the objectivity. You will come back to yourself. As long as the mind exists, the world of plurality will remain. When the mind dissolves, then pure Brahman alone remains. Mano matramidam sarvam chin mano jnana matrakam ajnana brahmamityahuhu vijnanam paramam padam. This world is the creation of the mind. When the mind is devoid of thoughts of the world, it is pure consciousness. A modification in the mind is the ignorance, and the supreme state of the pure self is the vijnana. So, we have covered this point before. that the whole creation is only a manifesting in the is the manifestation of the mind. How is it manifestation of the mind? Just like the dream world, mind alone becomes the whole world in the dream. Same way in the waking plane, mind alone has become the whole world in the waking plane. Take one step further. Mind alone has become the waking plane, dream plane, and deep sleep plane, and the absence of the two. It's the modification of the mind alone. Nothing has come from outside. It is nothing beyond the mind. Oh, but that was very transcendental. What was that? It was in your mind only. Ecstasy is in your mind. Emotions are in your mind. Kundalini is your mind. Kriya Yoga is in your mind. All the higher states of vibration, they are also in your mind only. Your mind is superimposing. This body thought is also in your mind. By God, I am responsible for the whole world. Yes. See, sometimes it overwhelms people. Therefore, they don't want to go in that direction. They don't want responsibility. She doesn't want responsibility of dog. No. Also. Forget the whole world. She's scared. My 14 years will get stuck and I just chavi de diyaar. So world is the creation of the mind. When the mind is devoid of thoughts of the world, it is pure consciousness. When there are no thoughts, then all that remains behind is pure consciousness. All the ornaments are useful. They are gold, but we call them ornaments. When they are all melted, no specificity is there. What is that general principle? Gold. Gold is as it is. It was there before, it is during, and it is after. But we forget the gold when we see the ornament. We may use, I want that gold ornament, not in silver. But your attention is on ornament, not on the material. And when this mind becomes zero, becomes devoid of all the thoughts of the world, thoughts of all objectivity, what remains behind is the pure consciousness. Nothing else. Not void, not emptiness, not nothingness. What remains behind is the pure consciousness. Or in other words, you can say, what remains behind is the conscious space, chidabhas. Chidakash, not chidabhas. What chidabhas? Chidakash remains behind. Conscious space. Then a modification in the mind is the ignorance. So any thought appearing in the mind, even one thought, and takes you away from the self. When will the thought appear? When will the thought appear? There is self-forgetfulness, then there is objectivity. But in the realized master we say, oh, he also speaks, he is also thinking. But he has come to realize that. When we are on the journey of realization, on being who we are, then initially, this is the initial, we are talking to the seeker. This is not being told to the realized master. About the realized master, we saw what was his disposition till now, till those 13, 14 verses. So to seeker is being told that if the mind is empty, what is left behind is chidakash or the pure consciousness. And if any thought is appearing, then that thought will take you away from yourself. Then there is corruption in the pure consciousness. What is that corruption? Takara. It's no longer chit consciousness. It has become chitta. It has become the mind. Appearance of one thought makes the consciousness into a mind. This has to be curtailed for a seeker. You can do it through pranayama, you can do it through japa, you can do it through meditation, vaikari madhyama pashyanti para, whichever way, There is no right or wrong way. Find out which works for you. Today maybe this path works, tomorrow maybe that path works. Oh, but they say you should follow one. You are the most unique person. You find out what works for you. Why someone has to tell you what works for you? You listen to yourself from inside. Scriptures are only a guide. You have to take that and apply and see if it is working for you or not. If this is not working, some other technique is given. If that is not working, take the next one. Every day you are a new person. Every day you are changing. New thoughts, you are grown by one day. Your health is not the same every day. Sometimes you are having, you can breathe easily, another day you can't breathe easily. And you try to do pranayama if your noses are blocked. You will create a headache. You can't do pranayama that day. Then you have to do something else. Don't feel guilty about it. Do that. Try that which works. And what works, it will come from within. Be available to it. Don't take a position. This is the only way, not any other way. You are doing disservice to yourself then. Continuing. How should one practice this knowledge from the Ishwara point of view? Ajnanam chanyatha jnanam.
Ajnanam chanyatha jnanam.
Maya metam vadantite.
Maya metam vadantite.
Ishwaram mahinam vidyat.
Ishwaram mahinam vidyat.
Mayatitam niranjanam.
Mayatitam niranjanam.
Ignorance and otherwise knowledge is called Maya. Ishwara is the controller of Maya, which is beyond the spell of Maya, is the pure self. Who is Ishwara and who is Jiva? Jiva is he who is under the control of Maya, meaning under the control of ignorance. Ignorance. Jiva is under the control of ignorance and therefore he is chatpataing to be free of everything and experience himself. Who is Ishwara? He who is the master of it, not ignorance. At the total level, it's called Maya. Don't say ignorance there. No, he's the master of ignorance. What do you mean by master of ignorance? Ignorance. Suddenly the term has to change. Otherwise, at the individual level, we are enslaved by the mind, and Ishwara is the master of the mind. At the totality level, that mind is called Maya. See, this is the difference. This is the only difference. So here, how should one practice this knowledge from Ishwara point of view? Be the master of the mind. Simple story over. Swamiji, that is very, you said it and it happens, is it? How do I, but then we start doubting and we start complicating that. But if the sneeze comes or if the hunger comes or if the desire comes, then what do I do? Do whatever is required. Don't succumb to it. That is the practice. Now, naturally the next question will come, how do I not succumb to it? You will try many different things. Then the scriptures tell you, the only one sure short way of not succumbing to it is, be self-aware. The more you remain as that, for some time you may slip. But as long as you remain in self-awareness, contemplating on the self, slowly those slips will become less and less and less and less, and one day it will stop completely, as long as your attention is on the self. This is the sure short way. This is the way it is to be brought about. So ignorance, the otherwise knowledge is called Maya. Ishwara is the controller of Maya. That which is beyond the spell of Maya is the pure self. So who is Ishwara? Jiva? Jiva doesn't know that he is the pure consciousness. He thinks he is an individual. He forget that also. He thinks he is the father, mother, daughter, sister. Who is Ishwara? What does he know? He is ever abiding in his essential nature. Ishvara has got no doubt that he is the Parabrahma. But at the same time, the moment he comes out of meditation, that very moment Maya starts multiplying into the whole Jagat. But because Maya is multiplying and becoming the whole world, Ishvara doesn't get, Ishvara's position doesn't get corrupted by her. He remains as Ishvara in spite of her becoming many. But Jiva becomes corrupted by that. If you can maintain that poise, therefore we say Bhagwan Ramana Maharishi, Bhagwan Satya Sai Baba, Bhagwan Nityananda. Why? That under any set of circumstance, any experience, anything that the world is throwing, any thought coming, they are ever in that poise. That is why we call them Bhagwan. Continuing. Sadanande chidakashe,
Sadanande chidakashe,
Maya megasta dinmanaha,
Maya megasta dinmanaha,
Ahanta garjanam tatra,
Ahanta garjanam tatra,
Arasarohi yattamaha,
Arasarohi yattamaha,
Mahamoha. Varshati Leelaya,
Devo Varshati Leelaya,
Asya Vrushter Viramaya,
Asya Vrushter Viramaya,
Prabodhaika Samiranaha,
Prabodhaika Samiranaha.
In the sky of Satchidananda, the Maya is the cloud. This is a simile given so that we can understand. In the sky of the Satchidananda, the Maya is the cloud, the mind is the lightning, and I am the body, notion is thundering. In that darkness, the ignorance is the torrential rains. In such darkness of delusion, Ishvara showers heavy rains, self-knowledge alone is the wind. Just close it. Come in. Just another few minutes and it will come. In such darkness of delusion, Ishvara showers heavy rains, self-knowledge alone is the wind, which can disperse these rains. And in this way, through this example, what was the first one? Sky of Satchidananda, the Chidakash. In that Chidakash, the mind is the lightning, and I am the body notion is thundering. Maya is the cloud, sorry. So where there are clouds, there has to be lightning and thundering. So Maya, in that Chidakash, as if ignorance has come about, self-forgetfulness has come about, and as a result of that, thundering and lightning is taking place, and that is of the I am body notion. And then in the darkness of the ignorance is the torrential rains in that Chidakash. Then, because Chidakash can never get corrupted, this is all imagined in that. And then by Ishvara Anugraha, by the Kripa of Ishvara, what happens? Heavy rains come. What do the heavy rains do? They wash away all the ignorance and blow away all the wind comes of self-knowledge by the grace of Ishvara, and it blows away the cloud of Maya. And this wind and it disperses the rains, and as a result that what you call, you can understand how the world is projected on the pure consciousness. So this example was taken. And when that happens, then what? When it is blown away, the ignorance is blown away, the clouds are blown away, then what remains behind?
Self.
Self alone. That is aparoksha anubhuti. That is abidance in the self. See? And the same idea is brought in our Puranas also. When the pralaya comes, same thing is told about. But in a pictorial form, in a story form. Here it is in very cryptical, and there it is in a story. Thus far we have mentioned jnana and vijnana. Vijnana means knowledge of the self. Jnana is knowledge of the other than the self. Now we shall go into greater depth regarding their practice or abhyasa. Jnanam drugdrushya yorbhanam.
Jnanam drugdrushya yorbhanam.
Vijnanam drushya shunyata.
Vijnanam drushya shunyata.
Ekamevadvayam
brahma. Ekamevadvayam
brahma. Nehananasti kinchana.
Nehananasti kinchana.
It says, the awareness of the seer and the seen is called jnanam. Obliteration of the seen and the direct immediate experience of the non-dual self, the one without a second, or Brahman, is the vijnana. So what is jnana? Thought knowledge is jnana, abidance in the self is vijnana. Objective knowledge is jnana, again, lower knowledge and higher knowledge. But truth is not lower knowledge and higher knowledge. Truth is beyond lower and higher. We don't want to create there, because truth is one without a second. So, taking in that spirit, but you understand this, that if the thoughts are there, it is knowledge. So, our definition of knowledge also must be clear. What? So many places in scriptures the word jnana, vijnana comes, which one you are talking about? Thought knowledge is jnana and self knowledge is vijnana. This is, in short, this is the understanding. And self-knowledge, and not only self-knowledge as an individual self, no, self that is all-inclusive, the Brahman, is the vijnan. The jnan vijnan are explained in another fashion in the following shloka. This reflects the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Kshetra kshetra jna yor jnanam.
Kshetra kshetra jna yor jnanam.
Tad jnanam jnanam uchyate.
Tad jnanam jnanam uchyate.
Vijnanam chobhayor aikyam.
Vijnanam chobhayor aikyam.
Kshetra jna paramatmanoho.
Kshetra jna paramatmanoho.
The knowledge about the kshetra and kshetra jna is called jnanam. The knowledge which declares the identity between the Kshetrajna and the Paramatma is called Vijnanam. They are trying to impress upon us what is pure knowledge. Vijnanam is pure knowledge, pure abidance. So, in 13th chapter Bhagavad Gita, their topic is Kshetra Kshetrajna Vibhaga Yoga Nama or something like this. So, what is Kshetra? Field. What is the field? This body is the field. Kshetrajna, the embodied. Who is the knower of the field? Who is the knower? I. This is, coming to this point is knowledge. That I am the embodied, and the body is the field, and the field is brought into activity because of the one who is the wielder of the field.
So this is the I in the duality, right?
I?
This is the I in the Dvaita, not the Advaita, not the soul.
Not the soul.
This is Advaita.
Not the soul.
Right.
This is the I.
Ahamkar.
Not Ahamkar. Okay. Not Ahamkar. It is the I, the witness,
right,
or the self, the Atma. But this is what you are missing, because yesterday you were not there. When we do, I am not this, I am not this, I am not this, what is left behind? I am is left behind. That I am is the one which is talked about. It is independent to matter. That consciousness that I am is independent to matter. When you come to this, it is knowledge. Then what is pure knowledge? Recognizing that this Atma that I am alone is Brahman. That is Vijnanam, that is being told here. Where are we? The knowledge which declares the identity between the Kshetrajna and the Paramatma. Who is the Kshetrajna? The one who is functioning through the field. Who is the wielder of the field? Who is that I? When this I is taken to be in its real sense, I told you different positions of it. And when you take it to be of the nature of Brahman, then it is called Vijnanam. Then after that, once you do that, then if someone says Tattvamasi, will he say I am that? For him, Tattvamasi doesn't mean anything. Scriptures don't mean anything. Aham Brahmasmi doesn't mean anything. Because he is already that. He doesn't need to do anything to be that anymore. He is already reached. Or he is already being what he started out to be one with. Yet another way to understand the Jnan-Vijnanam distinction is shown in the following shloka. Paroksham Shastra Jam Jnanam.
Paroksham Shastra Jam Jnanam.
Vijnanam Chatma Darshanam.
Vijnanam Chatma Darshanam.
Atmano Brahmana Samyaga.
Atmano Brahmana Samyaga.
Upadhi Dvaya Varjitam.
Upadhi Dvaya Varjitam.
The knowledge concerning the self, born as a result of the study of scriptures, and which is indirect and not experienced, is called Jnanam. The immediate and direct experience of the self after renunciation of the two conditionings of the Atman as the Jiva and Brahman as the Ishvara is called Vijnanam. How more clearly can Shankaracharya tell us? This is to impress on our mind. Don't get caught up anywhere, man. So here it is told, the knowledge concerning the self, born as a result of study of scriptures, which is indirect. Indirect means paroksha jnanam. Means through the words, all intellectual understanding is taking place that I am the self. This is knowledge. And what is the higher knowledge? Aparoksha anubhuti. Direct experience of the I, which is independent of the role as a jiva, and independent of the role as Ishvara. He has transcended both. That is Vijnanam. Recognize yourself to be that. That is where a realized master is abiding. Yet there is a fourth way of defining Jnanam and Ajnanam. He is giving example after example. Just to impress on our mind, we don't go the wrong way. We don't take a wrong position in our life when we are inquiring or meditating. Tvamartho vishaya jnanam.
Tvamartho vishaya jnanam.
Vijnanam tatpadashrayam.
Vijnanam tatpadashrayam.
Padayoraikya bodhastu.
Padayoraikya bodhastu.
Jnana vijnana sanjnakam.
Jnana vijnana sanjnakam.
To understand the implied meaning of the word tvam as I am the self is called jnanam. What is the implied meaning of I? As the
self.
As the atma is knowledge. Then to understand the implied meaning of the word tat as I am the Brahman is called Vijnanam. So now we are not taking, according to Panchadashi, you are not taking the I to be the Gaunatma, you are not taking the I to be Mithyatma, you are taking the I to be Mukhyatma. You are not taking the Tatpada, you are not taking the Tatpada to be any God, You are not taking the Tatpada to be any Ishwara, to be the Ishwara. You are taking the Tatpada to be the self. No, Brahman. What self? Brahman. So this is Vijnanam. So all duality, Ishwara, at the level of Ishwara also duality is expressing. What is that? Ishwara, Prakriti. Two are there. Brahman is called Ishwara with respect to Maya. That same Ishwara is called Jiva with respect to mind. Isn't it? The same infinite water, absolute water, is called ocean, Ishwara, with respect to total conditioning. And same water is called a wave with respect to individual conditioning. Understand? So we have to give up. Here the teacher is impressing on our mind that don't get caught up in duality, don't get caught up in any conditioning. What is the higher knowledge? That, so correct identity has to be given to the words. So what is knowledge? Here he says that...
Bhaktilpi say that, sir, in the previous sloka, self-pronunciation of two conditioning, the Atman as Jiva and Brahman as Ishwara. So here when I am saying I am the Brahman is called Vijnanam, isn't that a bit of a...
But theek hi to hai. We have to reach Brahman only. We are the Brahman. Where has it said that you are not supposed to take it as Brahman? Where? It has said Ishwara. Ishwara is not Brahman. Ishwara is total conditioning.
Okay.
Brahman is transcendental. Correct?
Yes, yes.
It's good, you are thinking.
Yeah.
Brahman plus Maya is Ishwara.
Yeah. Yes.
Correct.
Yeah.
So in this way, to understand the identity between the implied meaning of both Tvam and Tat together is called Jnana Vijnana. So we have to understand where we stand, when we are meditating, where are we? Where are we getting lost into? Whenever we use these words, what is the implied meaning? That we have to take. Because when I say Robin is a word in my mouth. But what is it indicating? It's indicated, there can be many Robin. No, none of you will say yes, Swamiji. Only she will be thinking in her mind, why is he taking again my example? Huh? If that thought is good. But only she will say, yeah, that's me. And she will have a smile or she will succumb again me. So whosoever name is taken, they will only feel that... So when we are taking the word jnana, these are the connotations, the four examples, these are the connotations. Don't get deviated by any, don't sidetrack your thinking. Come to this conclusion that as a knowledge, you are Atman, as a Vijnanam, you are the Brahman. So that is the lower and this is the absolute. Because we want to get to the absolute, we don't want to remain in limbo. Or everything else is a superimposition on the Brahman. Everything else, including Ishwara and Maya. But here, because we are talking about the consciousness, so the Maya is not being brought. So either that same Brahman is appearing as Ishwara, that same Ishwara is appearing as the Jiva, that same Jiva is appearing as the it's a phenomena, and that same Jiva is appearing as the ego, that same ego is forgetting that it is just, even if you take that and come back, you can still begin your journey back. But we go even further down. That ego then becomes the father, mother, daughter, sister and gets lost in the world. So position, what position you take while you are operating in this world, that is very, very, very important. So are you taking the position of knowledge or are you taking the position of pure knowledge? Pure knowledge is that which is transcendental. Knowledge is still conditioned. Continuing, the following shloka provides the fifth and one more interpretation of the jnanam and vijnanam. Atmanatma vivekastu.
Atmanatma vivekastu.
Jnanamahurmanishinaha.
Jnanamahurmanishinaha.
Ajnanam chanyatha loke.
Ajnanam chanyatha loke.
Vijnanam tanmayam jagat.
Vijnanam tanmayam jagat.
The discrimination between the self and the non-self is called jnanam. The otherwise or erroneous knowledge is called ajnanam, ignorance, and the whole world is the self is called the vijnanam by wise men. So just if you take these four and contemplate on these four, five examples, and everything is over after that. It will be crystal clear what your position is or should be. Then take that and run. Run and be.
Be.
Be. Not run.
Can't run.
Be.
Anywhere. No need to run.
No need to run. Be. Run into yourself, I should say. So here it is told, discrimination between the self and the not self is knowledge. Is jnanam. It is only at the thought level. Then ignorance is the ajnanam. That is, contrary knowledge to the discrimination is ajnanam. And what is vijnanam? That the whole world is the self alone. The self alone is the whole world. There is nothing outside the self. Now you have understood wave, you have understood water, you have understood. Now your understanding is everything is water. Vijnanam. Make that conclusion about yourself also. Individual conditioning, total conditioning is nothing but no conditioning also is equal to the self alone. So the totality of experience is nothing but the self. Coming to this conclusion, then there is nothing else to be there is nothing to seek, there is nothing to run away from, there is fearlessness, then there are, you are the living scripture. Then you are the living scripture. Then you don't need the scripture to ascertain who you are. And in this way, come to the correct understanding of vijnanam. Continuing, the student is still, after getting all these examples and the whole, how many, 50, 46 verses, he still says, how? How to do this? So here again the same thought. It came before also. Anvaya vyatirekabhyam.
Anvaya vyatirekabhyam.
Sarvatraikam prapashyati.
Sarvatraikam prapashyati.
Yattu tadvritti jamnyanam.
Yattu tadvritti jamnyanam.
Vijnanam jnanamatrakam. By the technique of presence and absence, that thought which is able to perceive the oneness in the many is called jnanam, while the self alone is and nothing else. This non-dual experience of the self is called vijnanam. Sixth one, This is again about jnanam vijnanam. Sixth way, the final one, I hope. Let me see. One more is there. So, what is it? The technique of presence and absence. Presence of what? Presence of thoughts. Absence of what? Absence of thought. Presence what? Presence of waking and dream. Absence of what? Absence of waking and dream. Who is witnessing? I am. That one, he says, that thought which is able to perceive the oneness in the many is called jnanam. So the one who is perceiving that there is, the mind is going through this presence and absence is called jnanam. In other words, you are the witness, witnessing something. That is the difference here between jnanam and vijnanam. Here you are the witness of presence and absence. And what is vijnanam? self-avoidance. Presence and absence are not even perceived. They may be there, but there is no perception of it. Meaning, here they are saying, while the self alone is and nothing else, this you cannot understand at the moment, that the self alone is. Even though it is happening to you all the time, but our obsession and insistence about the world and the body and the idea of Jeev Jagat Ishwar is so deeply ingrained, until unless we don't really keep coming closer consciously to our own self, meaning making the mind to come and eventually merge, this is that self alone is. First there must be intellectual conviction about this, that I am the self alone is. Then it has to become an aparoksha anubhuti. It told before, paroksha is jnanam, aparoksha is vijnanam. Aparoksha, direct experience. Paroksha, indirect experience of the self. So say, while the self alone is and nothing else, that means there is no sense of otherness, there is no sense of duality, there is no differences perceived at all.
Then why the phenomenon keeps still going for...
Wrong question.
Sorry.
Not sorry.
Why?
No, not wrong question. Now don't try to think of another question to ask me. Phenomena happens. Full stop.
Okay.
When you come to this point of vijnanam, of abidance, the self alone is there phenomena? Get there and find out. We say to about the great master that, oh, he is the body, he is also hungry, but you ask him, you cannot comment about the master. Why you cannot comment about the master and his disposition? Because the scriptures also refrain from telling the master what is disposition. They can only say, it must be like this, it must be like that. But they cannot conclusively tell you anything. How it is. All this is only a speculation that it could be like this. And why it is like this? Because these type of thoughts are telling us that is a state of abidance from where only oneness ensues. There is no duality after that. But we haven't had that experience of unity yet. The only place where we have experienced unity is in sleep, and that too out of ignorance. Some people have experienced a temporary unity called Nirvikalpa Samadhi, where they have come to themselves. But we are not talking about that, because that is also temporary. We are talking about that one who is in the Nirvikalpa Samadhi coming to this. So you know you are. But now that who you are as the self is all that there is. There is no one else other than it. There is no waking dream deep sleep. There is no world, there is no Ishwara, there is no God, nothing. Only self, 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 without a thought. It's too much to work out. You can't work it out.
Yeah.
But that is the transcendental state. That is the Turiya state.
Beyond logic.
Beyond logic. And therefore Taittiriya Upanishad says, Yato vacho nivartante. That state from where the words written, they cannot reveal. If I say Robin, Robin gets revealed. If I say Seema, Seema gets revealed. If I say camera, camera gets revealed. But when I say this vijnanam, the pure self, there's nothing to say after that. Aprapya manasa saha. It is that abidance where mind has got no entry. It is that sanctum sanctorium, which is, I shouldn't say sanctum sanctorium, that is the, from the devotional point of view, that is the Vaikuntha. That is the Vaikuntha. That is the conscious space. Continuing, here it says, okay, so that is, this non-dual experience of the self is called Vijnanam. One additional shloka further refines our understanding of the jnanam and vijnanam. Ajnana dvamsakam jnanam.
Ajnana dvamsakam jnanam.
Vijnanam chobhayatmakam.
Vijnanam chobhayatmakam.
Jnana vijnana nishteyam.
Jnana vijnana nishteyam.
Tat sat brahmani charpanam.
Tat sat brahmani charpanam.
The dispeller of ignorance is knowledge, jnanam. Both the jnanam and ignorance are illumined by the vijnanam. This jnana vijnana together abide in that supreme Brahman, which is eternal. So, what is ignorance? Is a thought, it's an idea of the, when we say the word ignorance, where is it appearing? In the mind only. When we say knowledge or I or the self, where is it appearing? In the mind alone. So, when we say knowledge cannot be removed by any thought, ignorance can be removed only by coming to know the self, right? So, ignorance has removed by coming to the self. Now, or if you take the knowledge to be thought knowledge and ignorance also to be the at the level of mind, it is at the level of mind. So, both knowledge and ignorance, who are they illumined by? No, not the mind. By the self. By the self.
They are a result of the mind.
Huh?
They are a result,
Of the mind.
Correct.
But the self is illuminating both of them. The knowledge also and the ignorance also. So, here the teacher is telling that that which dispels ignorance is knowledge, that is jnanam. Both knowledge and ignorance are illumined. So now you know there is no ignorance, I am the self. Who knows I am the, that you, the, you are saying I am the self? You know you went into Nirvikalpa Samadhi. You came out of Nirvikalpa Samadhi. When you are in Nirvikalpa Samadhi, knowledge has taken place. You are abiding in knowledge. When you come out of Nirvikalpa Samadhi, you are again back into the phenomena. And some people stop there. But going into Nirvikalpa Samadhi and coming out of it, both are phenomena. Who is illuminating both? That is our real nature. That we know. So who knows I went into Nirvikalpa Samadhi? I only know. Just like who knows that waking dream and deep sleep came and went? I only know. That's what we say. But that I which says I know is other than waker, dreamer and deep sleeper. Same way here also, in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Who knows who went into Nirvikalp and came out? Knowledge and ignorance, that one I am. That is Vijnanam. This Jnana Vijnanam together abide in that Supreme Brahman which is eternal. This is the phenomena which is going on. And where is this phenomena going on? Can it be outside Brahman? Can it be outside the reality? No. Goes on. Are the waves happening outside the water? No, they are in the water only. Are the ornaments outside the gold? In the gold. Are the thoughts outside the self? No. In the pure consciousness only the thoughts are coming. It cannot be outside. So knowledge and ignorance is both happening in the pure consciousness. So one is higher knowledge, one is the lower. Vijnanam and Jnanam. Continuing, where are we? Next verse. Dehabhimane galite.
Dehabhimane galite.
Vignate paramatmani.
Vignate paramatmani.
Yatra yatra mano yati.
Yatra yatra mano yati.
Tatra tatra samadhayaha.
Tatra tatra samadhayaha.
The object of contemplation is the self. It is not to prove the world is right.
Which one?
Am I wrong on the wrong one?
We're too far away.
Oh, okay. That was just an example there. I forgot there's no word.
He had to find us while we were sleeping.
Suddenly everyone is awake.
So we have to be in Vignana.
Yatra yatra mano yati tatra tatra samadaya. I mean, such a person who's established in that Vijnana, wherever his mind goes, there alone, can the mind go outside the self? Can the mind go outside the Brahman? That is what it is. Can the fish swim outside water? No. So thought also cannot come and go. Any experience cannot happen outside the pure consciousness. Cannot happen outside Brahman. And that Brahman I am. This is Vijnanam. Continuing. Bhokta sattva guna shuddho.
Bhokta sattva guna shuddho.
Bhoganam sadhanam rajah.
Bhoganam sadhanam rajah.
Bhogyam tamogunam prahuhu.
Bhogyam tamogunam prahuhu.
Atma chaisham prakashakah.
Atma chaisham prakashakah.
The sattva guna is the enjoyer. The rajo guna provides the instruments of enjoyment. The tamoguna creates the object of enjoyment, and the pure self is the illuminator of these. That is the enjoyer, the instruments of enjoyment, and the objects of enjoyment. To explain this relationless relationship between the world of matter, constituted of the three gunas of prakriti and the self, the definition and cause-effect relationship between the gunas and their functions are given by the teacher in this shloka. You can read it afterwards, you can read somewhere. But simply put, so sattva, rajas, tamas, where have they come? The maya has become, is expressing as sattva, rajas, tamas. And what does sattva, what does the sattva guna bring about? See, all knowledge takes place, enjoyer, enjoyed object, and the process of enjoying, or the instrument of enjoying. So in these three, what is the, again, sattva rajas tamas is three. Enjoyer, enjoyed, and enjoy, and the instrument of enjoying is three. So sattva is the enjoyer, tamas is the enjoyed, and rajas is the instrument, the mind. Understood? Without too many words. This is what it is true. And here it says that this phenomena is going on, man. To explain, and then, what is the pure self? What is the self? Self is the illuminator of these three. So can you stop thoughts coming in the mind? No. Let them come. Let them go. Even if I say, I know you. While I say, I know you, am I aware that these three, I know you, these three things happened, appeared? The I thought appeared, the knowing, I know that thought appeared, and you also appeared. And why? It cannot be I know. There has to be something in order to know. So I know you, Triputi. Who is knowing this, that? And if I say, hey, what did I say just now? I know you. What did he say?
Aham janami.
Aham janami. So, but if I go back and say, ask someone, says, Swamiji, what did you say? And I repeat the same thing again. If I ask you, what did I say? You will repeat it. Which means, I was observing, therefore I am able to bring it back and recollect it. Because I am illuminating these thoughts. Not only remember it, but also while they are happening, I am someone other than these three. This is what is being told here. To explain this relationless relationship, what is relationship? Relationless relationship? Just like that magnet was able to bring about in its presence, the inert iron filings became alive with movement. That is the relationless relationship. The sun is not saying anything to us, but we wake up in the morning. That is relationless relationship. There is no direct contact. Yet the effect is there. So to explain the relationless relationship between the world of matter, which is nothing but the three gunas and the play of the three gunas of the Prakriti, and the self. So meaning the play between subject and the object, the objective world. This is, I told you 2-3 classes ago, that subject and object, that means consciousness and matter. Well, let's not say subject and consciousness and matter. Take one step further back. Consciousness and matter can never be together. Yet it seems to be there. This is the phenomena. And this is the leela. This is the play. This is the divine game that is going on. And this is called the relationless relationship. They cannot come together, yet they seem to be together. The earth and the sky can never come together, yet on the horizon they seem to be together, isn't it? This is relationship, relationless relationship. Between the world of matter and the self, the definition and cause and effect relationship between the gunas and their functions are given by the teacher in this shloka. So I'm keeping it very simple without complicating it too much. And now but what is its deeper significance?
Brahmadhyayana-sanyukto
Brahmacharya-ratasada
Sarvam Brahmetiyo-veda
Brahmachari-sa-ucchate So here it is told that from the 50th verse, 51st, 52nd, 53rd, what is being told is from the brahmachari, grahast, vanaprast and the sannyas position, how does this jiva work out? And here it is told, the one who is constantly engaged in the study of the scriptures, that is the Upanishads, contemplation on the self, and who knows that everything is but Brahman, is called Brahmachari. So Brahmachari, what is Brahmachari? Our understanding of Brahmachari is
unmarried.
Someone who is unmarried, someone who is celibate, someone who has cut his hair and
kept a ponytail.
These are all physical attributes. But what is really the word meaning? The one who is walking the path of Brahman, the one who is living in Brahman, the one who is thinking of Brahman, he is a Brahmachari. So, as a student, what are the four avasthas? Brahmachari is the first in the childhood, 7 to 18, 20 is the period of Brahmacharya, Brahmachari, where you are studying, you are a student. Brahmachari is a student. And what is the topic of study, subject of study? The Brahman. Only that is the topic. This is what was used to be taught in the Gurukuls. Through the scriptures alone, but that was the main topic. And then he is consolidating it by meditating upon it, by being it. So that was the Brahmacharya Ashram. Who then may be called the Grahastha? Grahastho gunamadhyasthaha Shariram gruha muchyate
Guna kurvanti
karmani Naham karteti buddhiman The body is the house, the one who is in the midst of the properties of the body is the grahastha, the householder. The gunas perform all the actions. I am not the doer. Such a grahastha is a wise man. I am not the doer. Because ego expresses as the doer and the enjoyer. Doer and the enjoyer. So if in the grahastha, because what is a, who is a grahastha? Who's got so many responsibilities. But if he gets bogged down by all the responsibilities, he loses the plot. But if, you said it, nothing, not about you. But if that grahastha, that person who is living in the midst of properties, what is the properties? Sattva, rajas, tamas. How is that expressing? You have to buy a house, you have to earn the wealth, you have to perform your duties, you have to do the spiritual practices, you have to go to the temple, you have to take the children to the temple, you have to teach the children. You have, so many things are there. But as long as his disposition is that I am not the doer, all this is happening by the will of the Lord. Everything that I am doing, initially that will be how it is. Everything that I am prompted to do, even the thought that I have to be dutiful, to perform my duties, that also is prompted by the Lord alone. It is not my urge to take the responsibility. It is his inspiration. And as long as, and there are so many Mahatmas who have been grahasthas, by living, being in the grahastha ashram, they have come to realize the self. Janak Maharaj, Lahedi Maharashay, Tukaram, Tulsidas, Kabir. Eknath was married, Namdev was, I know. Eknath also?
Yes, Eknath,
Namdev.
Ravidas.
So, Akhandananji, he was also married. Mirabai was married.
So many rishis.
So all rishis are married. So to say that, oh, we are grahasthas, it's not a qualification for being miserable. Swamiji, what, you are sannyasi, it's okay. But we are grahasthas, you know. It is not a qualification to be miserable. So here, this verse clearly brings to our attention what should be our disposition. Don't become the doer. Let everything happen. Sincerely do what is required to be done. But while it is taking place, don't become the doer. Don't take on the doership. If the thought has come, oh, I have to take my child to the university or to wherever, do it. No complaints. No wanting to run away from that responsibility. But see how it unfolds. Remain in the poise. Non-doership is being in the poise. Doership is you have discarded the poise and taken on a personality. But giving up of personality or doership is falling back into your own poise, a poise of the self. See? Okay, so this is the grahastha. This is the second stage of life. Here Swamiji has written, this stage of life has very clear purpose of fulfilling the desires of dharma, artha, kama, moksha as per the rules laid down by our scriptures. Grahastha is tied down to the rope of attachment of me and mine. This rope is identifying self as body. He is caught up in the world. However, there are some wise householders, wise ones, huh? Not everyone. And who are you? How can you be the wise? Also, practice the Gyan Vigyan. You will fall into the place. Oh, who know and say, I am not the doer. The sadhana for a householder, therefore, is to give up the doership. Now, the third stage of our life is the Vanaprastha. Kimu graishcha tapo bhishcha.
Yes, yajnanamayam tapaha.
हर्षामर्षविनिर्मुक्तो वानप्रस्थस उच्यते He whose tapas, austerities, is knowledge, what is the use of very strict and difficult bodily austerities for him? The one who is freed from the thoughts of pleasure and pain is called Vanaprastha by the wise men. So what is Vanaprastha? Vanaprastha is a stage where it comes. When does it come? Is it a particular age that Vanaprastha begins? No. The day your children get married and are out, meaning they get matured, meaning when they become independent, they are getting their income, wash your hands. Then what do? Study scriptures every day, do your swadhyaya every day, do your meditation every day. That should be our pastime. Now you have done enough. Enough for them. Even the animal kingdom gives up their children after training them. And we human beings continue holding on till we die. Give it up. Now think of the higher. Spend more and more time in sadhana, meditation, pranayam, studies of the scripture, shravanam, mananam, nididhyasanam. And don't do austerities of the various yoga. This is one big problem. All those people, many in India also, huh? This Ramdev Baba has created big problem for Melbourne and Australia, in India. All these people, in their old age, at 55, 60, 65, they are looking at the video of Ramdev Baba and they are twisting their body and doing their pranayama. Okay, I can understand. After some time they give up, I can't get into those positions. But I can do pranayama. And what video can teach you how to do pranayama properly? And they all get into Kapalbhati, Bhastrika, Agnisar. At that age, your body cannot handle it. And invariably, everyone I have come across, they were healthy before, and they have all become. What happens with pranayama is you are shaking up everything that was dormant inside. All the problems come up at the body level and sometimes at the mind level also. Because they are not taking the next step. The next step is meditation or japa. That is not happening. Pranayam, pranayam, pranayam. Hey, Patanji, he is telling wrong or what? They take us. If you tell, you become the fool. But after looking at everyone, this is my conclusion. I may be wrong, I don't know. But you observe. And or if you are in that age group, you do it and find out. And then please give me the data. No? Simple, which is not shaking the whole system. That's what she said is right. Or what we saw in this text yesterday was just observing the breath. That is even simpler than Lom Anulom. Because again in Lom Anulom you have to bring the hand there. After some time it's going to get tired. Old man, middle-aged man is very difficult to keep. How long will you keep?
Our Swami said that to remove the gaseous toxins, do small pranayama.
Yeah, but you want to remove gas? Is your attention on gas or what the topic is, the self? But that is not the topic here. But that is... Chandrasekhar. That is not the topic here. The topic in Sadachar is coming to be the self. So here Vanaprastha is the shloka saying that do pranayama to do the sadhana, read the scriptures to remove gas. Yes, that, all those are there, you can do it. But that is not our primary goal. The life goal, the primary goal of our life in any stage, Brahmacharya, Grahastha and Vanaprastha now, in Brahmacharya was Brahmacharati. The one who is walking the path or being meditating on Brahman is Brahmachari. In Grahastha, I am not a doer, you are coming back to the being the pure self. In Vanaprastha, you have to come back to the pure self. Don't get distracted by where is the gas? In the body. Again, you are getting body identified.
Toxins
also. That's what I'm saying. At an older age, if you do lom, anulom, or any other type of pranayam, it's going to create too much agitation inside of you. You have to do something which is very, very gentle. Even lom, anulom is going to trouble you. And therefore, here it was told in the beginning, or what Raman Maharishi says, the simple way to avoid all these complications at the body and mind level is
observe
the breath, find the junction between the breath, do the japa, find the junction of the japa, and abide. Story over.
Even anulom vilom, there is an amount of control.
You will force it in. Nobody I have come across who does the lom anulom without force. Because they are in a hurry to finish it off. 20. Kitni jaldi. In lom anulom, if you want to really benefit from it, it has to be a natural breathing in and a natural breathing out. No forcing. Little bit force, something will start shifting inside of you. All these exercises of pranayam should be done when you are young, when your body is able to handle it. Don't do it in your old age. And this is not, I'm not saying it because just to discourage you. This is my observation with many, many people. Even in Melbourne, I know so many people who have done it and they are suffering because of it. But now they, you know, when you are suffering, then they are afraid to come in front of me because I told them not to. Now, how to say? Then they find all reasons to, nahi, Swamiji, this is not because of pranayama. This is because we know why it is. Anyway, let's continue. The third stage of life is Vanaprastha Ashram, withdrawal from the world. At this stage, the Grahastha must live as brother and sister at home. They should become independent. They should not be dependent on the partner. They should do swadhyaya. They should do their meditation. They should contemplate independently. Not compare. Acha, tune itne kiya, main itne kiya. Aise nahi. Now the time has come for him to renounce attachment with the world and the ego of doership and ownership. Stop living in the past. No more. Give all your photographs, collected memories to your children. Let them suffer. You continue. You empty yourself. You empty yourself. Vanaprastha, you should remain empty throughout, but Vanaprastha is a stage where you start now consciously emptying. First you are saying, I am not the doer. Now you are saying, I don't want to live in the past. How do we live in the past? In
memories.
Fond memories of life, of our children, of our childhood. Look at any old person, what are they talking about? Only about their childhood. No, they don't talk, but majority of the people, Swamiji, did you see some 80-year-old the other day, somewhere I was, Swamiji, see when I was a 5-year-old. Buddha hai samne mere. 80 years old, showing me with great joy, Swamiji, see my photograph when I was 5-year-old. You haven't grown up, man. You haven't grown up. During Vanaprastha, never spend a day without satsang. Means continuous exposure to the knowledge of the self. And remember my satsang on satsang. Satsang on satsang. So find one of the ways. Either with yourself, or with teacher, or with God, or with puja, or with a master, or with whichever way. Remain ever engaged in thinking about the higher, independently or with support, it does not matter. Important is continuously your mind is getting washed with such thoughts. And this is a stage where in Vanaprastha, one practices to remain undisturbed by what the life is throwing at him or her. One who can achieve the above is living in Vanaprastha ashram, even if he is living in and surrounded by the family. Even if he is living in and surrounded by the family. Change. You are not getting corrupted anymore.
Not changing
it. You know where you stand. You know who you are. You know what you are. You are ever in the poise. Last one, second last. Dehanyaso hi sanyaso.
Dehanyaso hi sanyaso.
Naiva kashaya vasasa.
Naiva kashaya vasasa.
Naham deho mahatmeti.
Naham deho mahatmeti.
Nishchayo jnana lakshanam.
Nishchayo jnana lakshanam.
Renunciation is the total rejection of I am the body notion. A renunciate is not a mere wearer of saffron clothes. Renunciation of I am the body notion is real sannyas. He alone is a Mahatma, here sannyasi, who is rooted in the knowledge that I am not the body, but I am the... So sannyas is tyag, is dispassion, is giving up, is letting go. Of what? Of the body identification. And what did we speak for so long? How can you give up body identification? No. It has to happen. How will it happen? When your attention is on the conscious principle, then alone it will happen. Just like body identification every night is dropped when your attention is on the sleep. It's happening to you every day. Bring it about consciously. But for that, you need a higher thought. You need to think about the self as the total, as the infinite. Then it will happen. This is the last stage in life is sannyasa. And a sannyasi is one who has given up the body identification, given up I am the body notion, and has recognized his true identity. And he has experienced his true identity, that he is the Supreme Self, living through all the bodies and not through any particular body. This is the sannyas. Even the sannyas, even a sannyasi, the attitude will make you give up the nirvikalpa samadhi also. Because that is also limiting. And when you give up nirvikalpa samadhi, then naturally the next, why you are giving up nirvikalpa samadhi? I don't want to escape from the world to know myself. I want to be the self in spite of everything. Is there a way? This was my question. And that's when Vedanta came into my life. To overhaul my mind with the new knowledge that there is a way. See? He firmly abides in the knowledge of Aham Brahmasmi. Because only that knowledge is all inclusive, isn't it? Last verse. Sadacharamimam nityam.
Sadacharamimam nityam.
Ye anusu anusandhadat nityam. Ye nusandhadate buddhaha.
Sansara-sagarat-shigram.
Mochyante-natra-sanshayah. Those wise men who regularly and constantly inquire and reflect on this Sadachara text, this is the Phala-shruti. This is the result of studying this text. Conclusion. They are liberated from the bondage of the world of transmigration. There is no doubt about it. Na sanshaya. There is no doubt about this conclusion. If you consciously, subjectively study this text, listen to this text, the disposition, discussion, then there is no possibility of transmigration, because you will come to the aparoksha anubhuti that I am all that there is. And in this way, a wise seeker who regularly inquires, contemplates and follows on the thoughts of Sadachar given in this text, he is liberated quickly from this relative ocean of existence, from the sansara sagara. No one should entertain any doubt about this. Hari Om Tat Sat. May this conclusion come to all of us in this lifetime. That is our prayer. We always finish by reading the first verse again. Satchidananda Kandaya Jagadankura Hetave Sadoditaya Purnaya Namo Nantaya Vishnave. So that Satchidanand, the union of Satchit and Anand, is the Kanda, and that I am, and this I am, this pure self that I am itself is the Jagadankara. That itself is the the cause or the impetus behind the appearance of the world. Sadoditaya, sada uditaya, udita, meaning it is ever arising, it is ever present. There is no moment in our life that the self is not. Every moment it is. In fact, time is because of it. It is not because of the time. Sadoditaya, purna, it is ever complete. Nothing is lacking in it. And namo anant, prostrations to this infinite and this Vishnave, meaning that it is the all-pervading self. It is not the individual self. It is the all-pervading pure consciousness. And this was the Mangala Charan. And with this, we conclude the Sadachar text. Thank you for allowing me to share. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om. Just sit for half a minute.